So are there any questions or issues people want to address at this point? No? All right, so let me move along then. So, I'm going to move on to the next topic unless people want me to go over work some more. I think work is pretty straightforward. It's just lead and hold force over the distance or whatever it is. The hard thing, as is always the case in these, is really setting up what the little element is that you're moving. So the next topic that we're moving on, that we're doing, is something that we've seen a little before. This is the idea of polar coordinates. So, but we will do some calculus in polar coordinates, so it's not good. But I'll, so this is, I think, Appendix H in the book. So just to remind you how polar coordinates work. Think of having, so if I want to describe a point here in the plane, rather than saying how far over I go in x and how high up I go in y, instead I indicate what angle I make with the x-axis, and then how far over I go along that angle. So this is the angle theta equals. Theta is the angle with the, let's call it the x-axis. It's actually the positive x-axis. And then r is usually a variable that we use for the distance to the origin. So this is something I think you've all seen before. And in the context, I mean, we can do this more generally, but typically in the context of this course, we're going to, well, so let's just do some standard stuff here first, I guess. So we can convert back and forth. From one coordinate system to the other, just by observing that we always have a little right triangle here. And in the right triangle, which I will redraw, here's theta. This distance is x. This distance is y, and this length is r, then we can just use trigonometry to see that r, well, so we can see that the cosine of theta is y over r, and the sine of theta is x over r. So that can give us, or if you prefer, the tangent of theta is y over x. So we can certainly get theta out of this just by taking the arctangent of y over x, although we have to pay attention to whether it's positive or negative. We have to pay attention to which quadrant it's in. So we might have to look at the sine, S-A-G-N, or the cosine of the sine, and figure out whether it's here where the tangent is positive or here. I'll do an example in a minute. Yeah. Tangent's still right. Okay, so we have that. And we also have that r squared is x squared plus y squared from the Pythagorean theorem. So this should be enough to allow us to convert from one, to convert points from one coordinate system to the other. And I suspect that you all did this before. Is there anyone who has never done this before? Really? And you actually went to high school? Okay. Shocking. Shocking! Okay. So the polar coordinates is really moving. Wow. Okay. So, and that means you have a little more practice to do than the other people who don't. So maybe I should do an example or two here. Just thinking of points. So that if we have, okay, so suppose we have the point r equals 2, theta equals, I don't know, pi over 4, in polar, obviously it's in polar because I'm, so, actually before I say that, so then what is it in rectangular coordinates? Or this is also sometimes called Cartesian, named after Descartes, who came up with this. So in Cartesian coordinates or rectangular coordinates, to do the conversion is pretty straightforward. We just look at the formula. Oh, I suppose they didn't write it quite down. So this means that x is r cosine theta and y is r sine theta. So this is pretty easy. We just plug in, right? So x is 2 cosine pi over 4 and y is 2 sine pi over 4. And the cosine of pi over 4 is, well, you could almost just draw the triangle to figure it out. I mean, this is saying in terms of the picture, that's a bad picture already. Pi over 4 is 45 degrees, or a quarter of a half of a right angle. And so if this length is 2, then this length is the square root of 2, and this length is the square root of 2. So I kind of don't even need the formula. I can just look at the picture and see that this is root 2. And this is root 2. Or I could remember that the cosine of root 4, of pi over 4, is 1 over root 2, and 2 over root 3 is the same as the square root of 2. So either way, it's fine. So that's pretty straightforward. Any question on that? Yeah? No? So, okay, so cosine pi over 4 is 1 over the root 2, 1 over root 2. And so 2 cosine pi over 4 is 2 over root 2. But I can divide this root 2. This is root 2 times root 2. That's another way to write 2. And I'm dividing by root 2, and so this is root 2. Sometimes, you know, people insist on writing this instead of 1 over root 2, root 2 over 2. So then I have 2 root 2 over root 2. Square root 2 squared plus square root 2 squared is 2 plus 2 is 4, and the square root of 4 is 2. The hypotenuse is 1 without the 2. With the 2, twice 1 is another way of saying 2 plus 2. Okay? Alright, so this is really easy, and going the other way is also really easy if we take a point like Cartesian coordinates, let's take, I don't know, I'm just going to make something up, negative 1, 3. And we want to, so this is not going to be a nice angle. So we're saying negative 1, 3, this point here. And I want to know what this is in polar. Well, certainly the angle will be between 90 degrees and 180 degrees, or between pi over 2. Pi, and so here r squared is x squared plus squared is 1 plus 3, or 1 plus 3 squared, which is 9. So R is 3. And theta, yeah, 10. What are those numbers? Square root of 10. And theta is whatever angle it is to get that angle. Here, so we have to take the arc tangent. So I know that the tangent of theta is y over x. And so theta is the arc tangent of negative 3. Which is not really a nice angle. I mean, it's just whatever it is. But it's the arctangent of negative 3. That is, there are two angles that give you negative 3 as their arctangent. There's this one, and there's this one. And we want this one. So it is the arctangent of negative 3, which is between pi over 2. Right. Any questions on that? No? Yes? Maybe? Okay. So we'll see that, but all right, whatever. So you can convert back and forth between these things. This is something that you should have done in high school. I'm really annoyed that you didn't do this in high school, but you know, it's not your fault. It's somebody else's fault. But, so, you'll have to play with these a little bit. A couple of things to notice about polar coordinates. So they're very useful in many applications. So for example, imagine if you are an air traffic controller, everything is done with polar coordinates. And often, you know, a lot of navigation and those kinds of things are done in polar coordinates because you say, thing is over there, a mile and a half. So that's naturally polar coordinates, because when we say over there, that's an angle. And then how far? A mile and a half. And I don't really know that this is, a mile and a half. Let's say it's that way 1 mile. So I don't really know whether this is route 2 miles west and route 2 miles north or whatever, because I don't have a compass with me to measure rectangles. So a lot of times, things are more naturally described in polar coordinates. So some issues with polar coordinates is that there's not really a unique theta. Right? Unlike with x and y, I tell you x, I tell you y, I know the place. So in the sense that theta equals 2 pi is the same angle as theta equals 0, just means I wrapped around once. And theta equals negative pi, so let's say pi over 2. Negative pi over 2, so again, this is just for those of you that are still unfamiliar. That's, what am I writing? So 360 degrees is the same as 0 degrees. It works a lot better in calculus if we use radians. But, okay, so this is negative 90 degrees is the same as theta equals 3 pi over 2, 270 degrees. And any multiple of 360 degrees added or subtracted doesn't change the point. It's useful, however, because we can think of, if we have something rotating around, we can measure how many times it went around. It's sort of human history. So it's both good and bad that theta is not unique. That is, if I want to describe something that started here and ended there, it might be more natural. Okay, let's put it down here. Let's put it here. You describe the angle of this as being 6 pi. Because I started at 0, sorry, 4 pi. Because I started at 0, I went around, I went one full turn, that's 2 pi, and then I went around again and I went another full turn, that's 4 pi. So while I end at the same place, so this place is not uniquely described by a given theta, there's sort of a history built in. This place is still y equals 0, and maybe x equals looks like 2. But if I say, if I describe this place as 2, 0, I don't have any sense of this thing turned around twice before I got there. So there's sort of a difference between describing this in polar as r equals 2, theta equals 4 pi, versus r equals 2, theta equals 0. They describe the same point, but this one sort of implies a history. So there's some advantage to this lack of uniqueness for describing points, because it lets you know about how things turned around. Okay, so that's one issue. Another issue, another issue is r equals 0 has every angle. Right? Once r is 0, theta is sort of not well defined. I could be distance 0 and angle 270. Or distance 0 and angle 0, or whatever. If I don't move, you can't tell which way I'm facing. So all of the thetas are at the same point. There's a little bit of a singularity at the place you are. So usually, but not always, theta between 0 and 2 pi, and we take r bigger than 0.
Well, or equal to 0 to describe the origin.
But we don't have to. And sometimes it's useful to allow r to be not to be negative. And so taking theta outside can be useful, and also r less than 0 can be useful. Naturally, if I'm facing this way and I want to describe 1 foot behind me, then I would say r is negative 1. Right? So this point here, the same point, r equals 2, theta equals 4 pi, which is the same point as r equals 2, theta equals 0, is also the same point as r equals negative 2, and theta is pi. Again, it's the same point. It means face this way, but back up to, well, but back up 2 units. So negative r means behind you. So this means that theta transforms you add pi to theta. Does that make sense? But if I want to transform something like, so let's go back to this same kind of conversion problem here.
for.
Oh, well.
So if I want to understand what is the point, so what is the Cartesian coordinates, it's called rectangular. Of r equals negative 2, theta equals 3 pi over 4. In terms of a picture, this is saying 3 pi over 4 is go a half turn, right? This is pi. What am I doing? I want 3 quarters of pi, so this is theta equals 3 pi over 4 here. And so I'm facing this way, so this is my positive axis, and this is my negative axis here. In terms of a picture, I face at theta equals 3 pi over 4, and then I back up 2 units. So this should have both x and y negative. Is this clear? How many of you have never seen this notion before, of a negative radius? Well, now that's interesting, because only 4 people have never seen the idea of a negative radius before, but like 15 people have never seen polar coordinates before. So something is strange.
But okay, maybe your arms are broken. I don't know.
Okay, so then what are the rectangular, how do I figure out the rectangular coordinates of this? I just draw this triangle, or I take the cosine, right? So my point in rectangular is going to be negative 2 times the cosine of 3 pi over 4. That's my x coordinate, and my y coordinate is negative 2 times the sine of 3 pi over 4, which is x equals, so the cosine of 3 pi over 4, so you know what that is. Is it wrong? Negative
2.
Yeah, negative. Right? So this is negative 2, if you like, as negative as root 2 over 2 negative. And the sine of 3 pi over 4 is positive root 2 over 2. Or 1 over root 2, whatever you want. So this is 2's cancel, and this gives me a negative root 2 as my y coordinate and a positive root 2 as my x coordinate, which is what we see here in the picture. This is root 2. This is root 2, but it's negative, and this is 2. Really helps a lot to think about where you are rather than just blindly plugging in so you don't make little mistakes like thinking that the cosine of 3 pi over 4 is positive or something like that. Oh, no. Okay. Well, I can't do what I was planning to do because it broke. Lovely. So I'll have to fix that. So I guess maybe I won't. Okay, so that's kind of boring in that we can just convert back and forth from the points. But calculus is not about coordinates. Well, it is kind of. But more about functions. So really what we want to do here is not think about how to describe locations in the plane, but how to describe things which vary, which gives us locations. Right? So really what we want to think about, and this is really where polar coordinates is useful, is to describe a further collection of functions that we weren't able to describe before. So for example, we can think about the radius being some function of the angle. We can also think about the angle being a function of the radius, but let's for the moment just stick to radius being given by the angle. That is, if I tell you the angle is pi, then you can calculate how far away it is. So one application of this is, you know, if I have, say, something in orbit, and I want to describe its orbit, then I can describe where it is in terms of the angle that I look at. And it might be more natural to say, you know, that at a certain angle, the thing is a thousand miles away, and at a different angle, it's 3,000 miles away. And I can describe this in terms of that. Rather than the specific one, let's try something easier. So let's take the easiest possible, well, the easiest possible thing is the radius is a constant. So that's a very simple function. What is the graph of this function? It's a circle, right? This is just all the points that are 2 units away from the origin. This is a much simpler graph than saying x squared plus y squared equals 4. So, I mean, a much simpler equation, a much simpler way to describe a circle. This is really easy, and this is a little more complicated. Or even worse, y is plus or minus the square root of 4 minus x squared. That's even uglier. But to describe this circle, it's a natural polar function. The radius is a constant, and theta is whatever it wants to be. For every theta, I get a radius, and the pole is the same one. So this is sort of the natural way to describe a circle. Just like when you learn about functions with x's and y's, the first things that you learn about are, say, the linear functions. So a linear function here say that the radius and the angle are the same. What kind of thing is this? How would we figure it out? Well, we can just start plotting points and then realize what the points are telling us. So when theta is zero, I'm not saying this is the best way, but it's a way to get some idea. So when theta is zero, the radius is zero. So when I look this way, I'm right there. And now, as I start to increase, so I take here theta being pi over 6, the radius is pi over 6. So when I'm looking this direction, it must feel kind of big, I'm here at pi over 6, which is about a half. So I've gone from looking this way and being at the center, looking that way, and as I look up, my angle increases. And as I continue to look on higher and higher angles, I go further and further out until when theta is pi over 2, I'm at pi over 2, which is about 2/3. And then I continue to grow my angle to when I'm looking this way, at angle theta equals pi, I'm 3 units away. 3.1415, blah, blah, blah. And then I continue. I'm looking now this way, and I'm even further out. And now I'm looking this way, and I'm even further out. And when I come all the way back, I'm at 2 pi. So it grows and grows and grows. And it will continue to grow. So here, this is where the non-uniqueness of the angle helps us, because we can continue to spiral more and more around and around. And as theta grows, my distance from the origin gets bigger and bigger. It's like I have a string, I have a, you know, I have a fishing line, and I just have it infinitely long, and I spin around, and I just let the line out and out and out and out, and it just goes very far away until it hits the moon, and then I'm done. But it just keeps spiraling around and around. Is this the whole graph? What did I miss? Nobody knows. Yeah.
Negative.
Yeah. Theta can also be negative. So I get a spiral for positive thetas, and I also get a spiral looking the other way for negative thetas. So really, so let's try that again. Theta positive looks like this, and it keeps going. And for theta negative, so let's just think about where this point is. I start for a small negative value. I look this way. This is a small negative theta, but r is behind me. So when theta is negative, I start at the origin, and I move behind. As my angle goes this way, I look more and more behind. So this point here is r equals negative pi over 2, theta equals negative pi over 2. At negative pi over 2, I'm looking this way. My radius is pi over 2 units behind me. And then I continue to look, and my radius is behind. So this point here is r equals negative pi, theta equals negative pi. And it continues to spiral out in the other direction. Now I'm sort of, so increasing theta from negative infinity, it spirals in, then I hit zero, and then it spirals out like that. It crosses itself at all of these places where, well, it crosses itself on the y-axis. Okay, are people confused by this? Is this reasonable? Okay, so even though this seems like, you know, so this very simple equation, r equals theta, gives rise to something that is extremely hard to describe in rectangular coordinates. So this is an Archimedean spiral. Can you leave enough room? So it spirals out proportional to the angle. Obviously, r equals 5 theta has the same shape, it's just bigger, and so on. Or sometimes it's called the spiral of Archimedes, but same thing. Okay, so now let's move along a little more. And so it was my plan. All sorts of clicker questions and show you all sorts of cool graphs and all that neat stuff. And it turns out that this computer's still mad at me. So, yeah. Next time I will definitely make sure that it's working. Because a lot of times these things get very hard to do by hand. And it's very useful to have technology to try and figure these out. So any questions about this? So far? How many of you were completely lost? How many of you are okay? It's good. One honest person. How many of you are completely following? Okay, good. I don't know whether you're honest or dishonest, but it's your handbook. Okay, so let's move along. How many of you have done, so of those of you that heard of polar coordinates, I hope it's not those of you that haven't, how many of you have studied functions in polar coordinates along this line? Like 3, 5. Okay, so let's move on to something else. In rectangular coordinates, the graphs of polynomials are sort of the next simplest object beyond the linear ones. This is not true for polar coordinates. Polar coordinates are sort of naturally and intimately related to trigonometric functions. So, really the next simplest thing would be something like r equals the sine of theta, or r equals the cosine of theta. Let's do the cosine. So, if you think about this for a minute, because the cosine is 2pi periodic, we only have to pay attention to theta between 0 and 2pi. Because the radius will repeat when theta is bigger than 2pi or less than 0. So we don't have to worry about theta outside of 0 to 2pi for this function. And again, let's, rather than trying to analyze this, we can analyze this via calculus and all sorts of things, but let's just sort of do it by thinking about what this has to be made for. So this is, this is our polar plane. So just to emphasize that it's polar, we're going to put in 45 degree angle lines. And then just to remember what the cosine of theta looks like.
Stop it. Go away.
Remember what the cosine looks like. The cosine starts out at 1. And at 2pi here, back to 1, so this is really the relevant bit of cosine that we need to think about. All right, this is at pi over 2, this is at pi, this is at 3pi over 2, and at 2pi. So those are really the points that we need to think about. So the first point that we get easily on the graph is here at polar coordinates 1, r equals 1, theta equals 0. And then as theta increases, if we had polar graph paper, it would look sort of like a series of concentric circles with rays running. So let's just think in terms of a polar graph paper. So I guess starting on my graph here. In fact, let me change my scale a little bit. I get a point on my graph here. At theta equals 0, r equals 1. That's at x is 1, y is 0. Because the cosine of 0 is 1. And then as the angle increases, the radius decreases. So instead of following this, I want to move in. As the angle increases, my radius increases, so the thing moves in. Until at pi over 2, it's in at the origin. So that means that as I move up here, I want to get, so my picture is not exactly right, but pretty close. So this point here is I'm looking this way, and my angle, my radius is 0 when I'm looking up. And in between, so say at theta equals pi over 4, r is 1 over the square root of 2 over 2 over 2, or whatever you want to call it, 0.7. Whatever it is. So we do that. And then how will it continue? Back to the beginning? You ended up going this way?
No, the other way.
Right, I will get a circle. Now, is this really a circle? Well, you had a 50-50 shot. Well, I guess you said, I mean, maybe it's 45-45, and then there's 10% of maybe. Exactly. Maybe is maybe the best answer at this point.
I don't know. How can we check?
In fact, it is a circle, but how would we know? So this is a circle. It works out to be a circle. In fact, sometimes trigonometric functions are also called circular functions. It's not an accident. So this describes a circle, but notice that it goes around the circle twice. So one thing to notice is that this piece of the graph gives us the whole circle. Down here, let me go through this argument. I skipped ahead. So when I'm to get these points down here, that means I'm looking this way. I'm looking this way, but my R is negative, so I land there. It takes a little bit of changing your brain to think about these things. But if I'm looking this way, so when theta is, let's say, 3 pi over 4, then my radius is the cosine of 3 pi over 4, which is negative root 2 over 2. So when I'm looking here at a 45 degree angle this way, well, the 135 degree angle, I back up to get my point on the circle. And as I continue to look through this quadrant, I sweep out this part of the circle until when I'm looking east, the point is negative 1 unit behind me. You're so confused. I don't blame you. I'm confused too. So, let me... So, those of you that are so confused, it's okay, right? Part of what is supposed to go on when you are in college is you're supposed to be exposed to new things, and they're supposed to make your head hurt until you understand how they work. And then your head goes, oh, that's cool. Or you go, yeah, okay, fine. But in either way, it's confusing until you get it. So it should be a good feeling that you're confused. Because it'll get better. It's a bad feeling when you go, yeah, I know it all, and then you do the problems and you discover you're confused. That's worse. And I know that happens to a lot of people, like last, because they're staying on there. Okay, so let's carry on a little bit more. So let me just go through, let me do the sum. It's exactly the same, but different. What do you think this will be? A circle. Good. Will it be this circle? It'll be up. Why will it be up? Well, let's see. Well, the sign isn't always positive. Oh, really? Nice book. It's fine. So let's think about what the graph of the sine looks like between 0 and 2 pi. It looks like this. The sine is positive. I probably should have done the sine first. So that's a little easier. For angles between 0 and pi, we start out at 0. Our radius increases until when we're looking this way, our radius has gone all the way up to 1. So this is, I didn't leave enough room. So here, when theta is pi over 2, or 90 degrees, the radius is 1. So the radius starts at 0, it grows and grows and grows, but it grows quickly and then slower. Just like here, it grows quickly and then slower. until at one it gets as far away as it's going to go. And then the radius decreases back to zero. Then, when we're down in this quadrant, it's this piece of the graph, the radius is negative. So down here, we're looking down this way, but the point is behind us. The radius goes from 0 to negative 1. And then from negative 1 back to 0, as I do this way. So it's not that these angles down here don't exist, it's that when we look this way, the thing is behind. The same thing is happening here for the cosine. I'm sorry, I should have done the sine first. I was thinking it would be easier than I thought. So for the cosine, let's describe the cosine again, maybe in easier coordinates. For those of you who got confused by the negative angle. So I'm going to do r is the cosine where theta, instead of going from 0 to 2 pi, let's go from negative pi to pi. From negative, actually, let's go from negative pi over 2. Pi over 2. Let's go from negative 90 degrees to positive 90 degrees to describe the cosine. Maybe it's a little easier. So in that case, again, we already did this positive half. We start out here at a radius of 1 for theta equals 0, and it pulls into the origin. But let's do the negative angles now. When theta is negative, I take the cosine of this negative angle. So think of theta going from 0 to negative pi over 2. And look at the graph of the cosine in rectangular coordinates. It looks like this, where this is negative pi over 2. And this is positive pi over 2. So in the positive part, I start here at 1, and my radius decreases. And if I go backwards, I start here at 1, and my radius decreases. So when I go backwards, I sweep out this part of the circle. So here this is theta equals 0, and I start at 1. And if I go positive angles, my radius decreases. And if I go negative angles, my radius decreases. So how can we tell that this is really a circle? How would it be? I mean, it looks like a circle. How can I know that it really is a circle in my usual sense of knowing that it's a circle? What's one way I could know? How can I recognize a circle? Okay, but the radius from the center is constant. So I want to see that the radius from the center is constant. So how would I know that? Well, what is true in this case? What do I need to be true?
The radius equals the negative radius.
When you say the radius, this implies it's measured from the center, but our equation is measured from the origin. So how can I convert this? So my belief, my claim, is that r equals sine theta is a circle with center at x equals 0, y equals 1, and radius, not r, r, radius, 1. Right? That's what this picture claims. R equals sine theta should have this, one half. Right? That's what we believe to be true based on the picture. How can we check? No one has a clue? Yeah. You could switch it to, I don't have time now. Switch it to Cartesian coordinates, and it should look like x squared plus y minus 1 half squared equals 1. So if you switch to Cartesian coordinates, you should see this. What's another way I can tell? Then I'll be done. Check that the distance of every point here to this is 1 half. That is, I mean, you can do it sort of entirely and wholly by noticing that the distance is 1 half. The distance is just to subtract off. Okay, so next time I will do a little more with polar graphs and then we'll do some calculus with polar graphs. And the computer, I hope, will work. But it's for those of you that are still planning to move down to math 131 or math 126, the form needs to be signed. I can sign it, but it should be signed by the instructor of the classroom moving into or by the math department.